Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to be continuing my little pregnancy segment. In case you didn't see the previous video, I was talking all about skincare ingredients to avoid during pregnancy. Today I'm going to be talking about skincare ingredients you probably could use during pregnancy. I'm not saying you should use them, just you could if you need to. And then in the next video, I'm going to be talking about treatments that you could potentially do. For all of you who are new to the channel at the moment, yes, I am 7.5 months pregnant. Here's a picture of me thinner. I just like to remind myself that it won't always be this way. Even if you're not pregnant right now, maybe you know someone who is, maybe you're planning on it, doesn't matter. Watch the video anyway, because I think you might find that there are some interesting tidbits of information in there that maybe you didn't know about skincare ingredients. Let's talk about vitamin C first. Well, if you go to the NHS website, you'll see that vitamin C is recommended in pregnancy, and it gives you a nice long list of different foods that you can eat which contain vitamin C, suggesting to me that it's probably safe. In case that's not enough for you and you're looking for something a bit more robust, then check this out. In this particular study, 384 pregnant women were randomly assigned to receive either 400 milligrams of vitamin C per day or not. And a statistically significant difference was found between the two groups. Basically, the ones in the vitamin C group were hospitalized less. As you probably are aware, many pregnant women suffer from melasma, otherwise known as the mask of pregnancy. Vitamin C has really become a skincare staple in the average person's daily skincare routine for a lot of folk. There are many benefits to using vitamin C. So as you can see from this 2020 paper, they list the benefits as being its ability to scavenge reactive oxygen species to prevent skin injury, protect against UV light, upregulate neocollagenesis, and strengthen the dermal-epidermal junction. Now, this part is quite interesting. One of the other effects of vitamin C is its ability to chelate copper ions, which are cofactors in the enzymatic reaction producing tyrosinase. So when you deliver the vitamin C into the skin, to the basal epidermis layer, it should in theory prevent melanogenesis. One of the problems with using a vitamin C serum topically is obviously the outside layers of the skin are very fatty. A lot of the formulations are very hydrophilic, so they're water loving, so they don't penetrate through the stratum corneum. So it's been shown that by lowering the pH of the topical formulation can increase the absorption of the vitamin C, and also it can help with stabilizing the product from oxidation. However, if you use a vitamin C that's got a pH of equal or less than 3.5, it can lead to skin irritation, including burning and local inflammation. This particular study looks at Tetrahexyldecyl ascorbate, which you can find in products such as Dr. Barbara Sturm, the Good C Vitamin C Serum, and Medicate C Tetra. In combination with 100% mineral-based sunscreen during the summer, it was found that there was an average improvement in hyperpigmentation of 33.7%. Interestingly, the study also demonstrated an improvement in the vascular aspects of the melasma, not only the pigmentation. This may blow your mind slightly. So this particular topical, THD, has been classified as a quasi-drug by the Japanese authorities. Obviously, that made me wonder, who are these authorities and what gives them such authority? And it is apparently the Ministry of Health, Labour and Welfare of Japan. And this is because it has proven efficacy for skin whitening. Obviously, looking at this sent me off into a massive rabbit hole. So then I started looking at the regulation of quasi-drugs in Japan. Skin lightening or whitening quasi-drugs are a group of functional cosmetics. This term was created in Japan, and it basically means that they need to be approved by the Japanese Ministry of Health, Labour and Welfare, which is a bit of a mouthful. Until the late 80s, these mainly comprised of vitamin C and placental extracts, interestingly. However, from 88 onwards, with the introduction of kojic acid, that category started expanding significantly. As I mentioned, the first two things were the ascorbic acid and the placental derivatives. And as you can see from this paper, the L-ascorbic acid has a decent amount of evidence behind it, and you're probably all familiar with its use. What you might not be familiar with is the placental extracts, which are a little bit more out there. But this is a video about pregnancy skincare, so it is somewhat apt to discuss. Previously, bovine sources were used for these placental derivatives. However, after the whole mad cow disease thing, they moved over to using swine placenta. Why? What's the point? Well, there are various different amino acids and minerals that are present at high concentrations in the placenta. And it has been reported in a couple of studies that the increase in cellular turnover helps to lift out the pigmentation from the skin. The use of this is obviously somewhat sketchy, otherwise we'd all be doing it. And also a few papers have shown that instead of decreasing pigmentation, it actually causes an increase in pigmentation. And when human placenta was used, something that you ladies might be considering at home, it was found to actually increase the rate of melanogenesis. Another ingredient is kojic acid, which is a derivative obtained from the fermentation of liquor, which has an antibacterial activity. As you can see from this paper, it inhibits the activity of tyrosinase by chelating the copper atoms at the active site. And in the clinical trials, a 1% kojic acid containing formulation was shown to be effective for treating pigmentary disorders such as melasma and PIH. Tranexamic acid is also on this list. Tranexamic acid is having a bit of a moment right now. However, it's normally taken orally to help with bleeding disorders. And I did not know that Shiseido first came up with this use in 2002. Super interesting. There are also a bunch of other ingredients that you're probably familiar with, and maybe some that you're not, which are Arbutin, also obtained by Shiseido, smart company, Ellagic acid, Chamomilla extract, Rucinol, Linoleic acid, 4-MSK, Adenosine monophosphate disodium salt, Magnolignan, 4-HPB, and this ester of tranexamic acid. And then in this final paper, looking at maternal levels of serum vitamin C and E on birth weight and length, it basically says that if you have a higher level of these two vitamins, you're gonna do better. So in conclusion, you're probably fine to use your vitamin C. Okay, the next ingredient I'm gonna talk about is azelaic acid, which is a product kind of having its day in the sun right now. I do love azelaic acid. It has a systemic absorption of about 4%, and it's antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory, decreases PIH, and is comedolytic. I like my azelaic acid in either the Perfect Cleanser or in the Epion's Lytic TX range. Azelaic acid has been shown to be useful in the treatment of rosacea, acne, and hyperpigmentation. According to this review, azelaic acid has a cytotoxic effect on the melanocyte. Although the reason for this selective cytotoxic action of the azelaic acid is unclear, but it might be related to the inhibition of DNA synthesis. Interestingly, in various control studies, topical azelaic acid has shown to be comparable in terms of its anti-acne effect to topical tretinoin, benzoyl peroxide, erythromycin, and oral tetracycline. And in patients with melasma, azelaic acid has been shown to be at least as effective as topical hydroquinone. And in the same paper, they say that the 20% azelaic acid, when administered twice per day over 6 months, was comparable to using a topical 4% hydroquinone cream and was significantly superior to using a 2% hydroquinone cream in reducing pigmentation and lesion size. Which sounds mad, doesn't it? However, they do also say that the incidence of local skin irritation with using the 20% azelaic acid is comparable to using the 2 to 4% hydroquinone cream. Which, if you recall in the previous video, hydroquinone is one of the products that you're recommended not to use during pregnancy. However, this was largely due to the potential for skin irritation and reactivity. So I don't really know why they're saying it's cool to use azelaic acid but not hydroquinone, but that's what it's been said. If you like the content that's coming up here, you might want to consider subscribing to the channel. We do talk a lot about cosmetic procedures and also things that support that, like skincare, for example, supplements and hormonal health. But my main bag is always going to be about the injections. Next up, we've got the acids. So let's talk about the AHAs first. I'm talking about glycolic acid, lactic acid, tartaric acid, citric acid, and malic acid. So speaking about the glycolic acid specifically, that's got an absorption rate of up to 27% through the skin. So AHAs are super interesting because, as you probably know, they're found throughout various different natural sources such as sugarcane, glycolic acid, sour milk, lactic acid, you know, the whole Cleopatra bathing in the sour milk thing, fruits with the citric and the malic acid. But the ones used in your skincare regime are generally synthetically produced. If you remember your science, you'll probably remember that citric, malic and lactic acid are all used in the Krebs cycle. Citric acid has been found to increase the skin renewal rate, but you might be interested to know that it's been postulated this is because it activates apoptosis in cells, and in this paper it says rather dramatically, it activates the cell death receptors. Malic acid has been shown to have antibacterial properties, and it has been used to treat a certain type of listeria. This paper just speaks to the utility of using AHAs for photorejuvenation, and it demonstrates that collagen 1 and procollagen 1 were increased after using peels from glycolic, lactic and citric acid. You're probably all familiar with lactic and glycolic acid. Lactic acid has been shown to be less irritating, and it forms part of the skin's natural moisturising complex. Lactic acid's having a moment as well due to the increased interest in microbiome balancing products. And there are several clinical trials showing that the use of probiotics in the skin has been shown to be beneficial. Interestingly, lactic acid maintains intestinal microflora through acid-base balancing properties. Okay, so this is pretty interesting. There's been some research to show that lactic acid can be regulated by neuropeptides in the skin, such as substance P, which is a thing which is in the skin. Just as an aside, it's in the gut as well, and it acts as a bidirectional communication network between the two. Substance P is a major mediator of inflammation, which is hot right now. That's an inflammation joke. And it contributes to various different skin diseases such as psoriasis, atopic dermatitis, and acne. So that means that substance P regulated lactic acid release has implications for inflammation in the skin and also on the gut-skin axis. The other acid that I just want to spend a bit of time talking about is glycolic acid. And one of my favourite glycolic acids is the Obagi Exfoliating Day Lotion. You might have heard of glycolic acid as being one of the more effective alpha-hydroxy acids for sun damage. And this is due to its ability to increase epidermal and dermal hyaluronic acid amount, increase keratinocyte and fibroblast proliferation rate, stimulate collagen production, and improve the quality of the elastic fibers. It's also been reported to inhibit melanin synthesis and induce a shedding of the outermost layers of the epidermis by breaking the connection between the superficial cells. It's often said that glycolic acid is one of the more effective ones due to its smaller molecular size. And you may also be interested to know that glycolic acid has been found to be effective against UVB. This was demonstrated in a clinical paper looking at concentrations of 1-2% glycolic acid. At these concentrations, it was found that it reduced the UVB inflammation. However, at concentrations of 3% and 5%, it was found to increase the inflammation. If you're struggling with acne in pregnancy and you find it difficult to use glycolic acid, one thing you may want to consider is the mandelic acid. That's in products such as the Glowbiotics Clarifying Home Peel. It's much less irritating than glycolic acid because the molecule's larger, so that slows the absorption rate. So in terms of safety information, safety data, there's not actually that much pertaining to these AHAs. However, what I can tell you is that in this particular paper, peels using glycolic acid at concentration range 30 to 70% are generally considered safe due to negligible dermal penetration. Although according to this study, up to 27% is absorbed via the skin, depending on the pH, the concentration and the time. They've also said in this paper that lactic acid, up to 2%, has been used anecdotally to treat gestational acne with no reported fetal risks. Well, they haven't referenced it, so I don't know where that's coming from exactly. They also talk about salicylic acid, which is normally put under the BHA heading. This has an absorption anywhere from being undetectable to up to 25%. According to this paper, salicylic acid is often described as a BHA, but they state that the classification is incorrect due to the position of the hydroxyl and carboxyl groups. Anyway, it says on the basis of knowledge to date, salicylic acid does not function physiologically or therapeutically as a BHA. According to this paper, salicylic acid is classified as a pregnancy category C drug. Salicylic acid has been classified as a category C drug by the FDA, which shows that there is some harm known to be caused to the fetus, but the benefits of using the drug may outweigh the risks. So it's kind of one of those grey area drugs. Often it's said that it's safe during pregnancy to use products up to 2% salicylic acid. And again, Epion's have got some really nice ones. They've got the purifying toner and they've got the purifying wash as well as their Lytic TX range. Not sponsored by Epion's. One thing that did spring to my mind was that salicylic acid is related to aspirin. They're both salicylates, right? Aspirin is used as a prevention for preeclampsia. So I'm taking 150 milligrams of aspirin every day as a preeclampsia prevention, as recommended by my obstetrician. Now, I'm not saying it's the same thing, because obviously they're different, but I guess if it's fine to take 150 milligrams of aspirin, you could probably use, well, as much salicylic acid as you want within reason. I don't know why you would want to use more than 2% though. The last one is the polyhydroxy acids. And here we're looking at gluconolactone and succinic acid. There are a ton of products out there containing PHAs these days. Examples might be PCA Skin Acne Cream, Neostrata Restore Ultra Moisturizing Face Cream, and Neostrata Bionic Face Cream. Similar to a lot of the other acids, there are papers out there showing that gluconolactone is active against UV-induced sun damage. Generally speaking, any topical agent is always going to be less well absorbed than something that you've taken orally. Some topical medications don't even have a pregnancy risk category rating because the absorption is considered to be extremely minimal. And this group of the PHAs is in that category. Dapsone is an interesting one. So Dapsone is a prescription only product. It's a sulfone, which is available either as a 5% or a 7.5% gel, and it's thought to work as an anti-inflammatory agent. It's frequently used with benzoyl peroxide. Interestingly, you probably shouldn't use it alongside benzoyl peroxide because it can cause this weird orangey hue, which can just be brushed off. And it's also classified as a pregnancy risk category C by the FDA. One thing I haven't really touched on is hyaluronic acid. That's also in the safe category. In this review paper, they looked at various different products to see if any could help to prevent striae gravidarum or stretch marks. One of the skincare ingredients that they discussed was hyaluronic acid, which is thought to improve tensile resistance against mechanical forces and also counteract atrophy by stimulating the fibroblasts to produce collagen. The exact mechanism is unclear. Anyway, in these small studies, it did show that it was effective in helping to reduce stretch mark appearance. There's nothing actually to say, oh yeah, hyaluronic acid is safe. I think this is just, one of those ingredients that the general assumption is that yes, it's safe to use. I will be doing another video about stretch marks at some point in the future. The last thing I wanted to talk about was Bakuchiol. This can be found in products such as the Medicate Bakuchiol Peptides and the snappily titled Cosmetics Elite Alta A Daily Bakuchiol Rejuvenation Moisturizer. Don't have a drink before you say that. In this small clinical trial of just 44 patients, they were asked to apply either the Bakuchiol 0.5% cream twice a day or a retinol 0.5% cream daily. That's interesting, isn't it? Daily. So one was twice a day, one was daily. Crafty. See, quite often you can get the clinical studies to say whatever you want them to say. Anyway, in the results, the Bakuchiol and the retinol both significantly decreased wrinkle surface area and hyperpigmentation, and there was no statistical difference between the compounds, but the retinol users reported more facial skin scaling and stinging. The authors concluded that the Bakuchiol was a promising ingredient as it was more tolerable than retinol. It will be if you're using it half the time, right? Anyway, the point is, can you use it in pregnancy or not? Although it's often said that Bakuchiol will act in a similar way to a retinol, it doesn't act on the retinoic acid receptor, and tretinoin does act on this receptor. One of the important points about Bakuchiol that I lifted from a blog called Honesty for Your Skin is about why there might not be data for this. And she concluded that there was not enough of it being imported to necessitate a higher level of safety testing. Anyway, she goes into an excruciating amount of detail about it, so I will link the blog below should you be interested in reading it. The upshot of it was that yes, she would use it. Okay guys, that's it for today. Hope you enjoyed the video. One thing that I didn't put in that probably won't make sense unless you've seen the previous video is about benzoyl peroxide, because I haven't mentioned it in this one, but I mentioned it in the previous one. Basically, you can use it in certain parameters. Anyway, that's it for this week. So next time I'm going to be making a bit more pregnancy slash procedure content. I'll see you later.